Assalamu alaikum. I'm Dr. Simon Asim, Associate Professor, Pathology Department, DIMC. Today, the topic of the lecture is Clostridium species.
Landscape कर दीजिए. जी मैम, अब ठीक है.
ठीक है.
Okay, मैं शुरू कर दीजिए.
Okay. Sorry for the inconvenience. Okay, now the lecture objectives of the today's topic are that you will be able to understand what are the what is the Clostridium and its species, then the diseases caused by this bacteria, and what are the different laboratory tests to diagnose this bacterial infection. Okay, so first of all, the most important thing is that we should know what is the difference between gram positive bacteria and gram negative bacteria. Here in this slide, you can see that a staining procedure has been shown for both the gram-positive bacteria and the gram-negative bacteria. And here you can see different stain has been used one by one. And in the last, the gram-positive bacteria, they are stained purple, while the gram-negative bacteria, they are stained pink. So this is the main difference. And as well as the other important difference that after being used by the decolorizer, the gram negative, they become colorless, while the whether the same same time has been given to both the bacteria, and the gram positive, they remain purple. So this is the main difference between the gram negative and gram positive bacteria. Now coming to the types of the gram positive bacteria, what are the two different types of gram-positive bacteria, that is gram-positive cocci and gram-positive bacilli. Okay, now today the lecture is on gram-positive rods. Okay, so there are four genera of gram-positive rods, that is Bacillus, Clostridium, Corynebacterium and Listeria. Okay, now as we are going to study the Clostridium, so it comes in the category of spore-forming bacteria. The gram-positive bacteria are of two types, spore-forming and non-spore-forming. The spore-forming are of two types, that is Bacillus and Clostridium, and the non-spore-forming are the Corynebacterium and Listeria. Okay, now coming to the main topic, that is Clostridium, which is gram-positive bacilli that stains purple after gram staining. Then there are four species of Clostridium, and they are all anaerobic and spore-forming. That is very important to remember that these are all anaerobes and they all form spores. Okay. Now coming one by one, what are the different types of these species? So first of all, we will see what is a Clostridium tetani. Okay, so Clostridium tetani causes a disease known as tetanus, and this disease is usually transmitted by means of a contaminated soil or foreign objects. And these contaminated soil usually contains this bacteria. And the mostly the portal of entry is a wound, and wound can be caused by any nail or a glass splinter and skin popping, which is basically a technique which is used by the drug addicts to inject drugs into the skin. And what happens after being transmitted in the wound, the germination of the spores is favored by the necrotic tissue and the poor blood supply in the wound. So this is mainly the transmission of Clostridium tetani. And another very important transmission is through contaminated umbilicus or circumcision wound, which may cause neonatal tetanus, okay? Which is very life-threatening for the neonates, newborn fetus. Okay, now Clostridium tetani, the pathogenesis involves the release of exotoxin. The main exotoxin of the Clostridium tetani is tetanospasmin, which is a neurotoxin and which is produced at the womb site. And its toxicity is very strong, and it is considered one of the most toxic substances known. And they actually are proteases that cleave the proteins involving mediator release. And this toxin is basically carried intra-axonally retrograde to the CNS, where it binds to the ganglioside receptors and blocks release of inhibitory mediators, that is glycine and GABA, एट द स्पाइनस साइनसिस. दिस टॉक्सिन हैज ओनली वन एंटीजेनिक टाइप एंड this is why the vaccine is available, being easy for having one antigenic type. Now coming to the clinical findings of the Clostridium tetani. Main clinical finding is cramping and twitching of muscles around a wound. And in this, visually patient has no fever, rather he sweats profusely and he also experiences pain in the area of the wound. Another very specific clinical findings in such patient is muscle spasm. And the specificity of this muscle spasm is that the person has spastic paralysis, or you can say a tetany, in which there is a increased and rigid contraction of the muscles take place, especially of the this jaw, which is known as lock jaw or trismus, which is a rigid contraction of the jaw muscles, which prevents the mouth from opening, giving a characteristic grimace known as risus sardonicus, facial features that shows increase or exaggerated reflexes due to contraction of the facial muscles. Then another very specific feature which is seen in this disease is opposite, which is called arch. Okay. Now I will be slow. So the muscle spasm in this kind of disease is a specific contraction of the muscles of the jaw, which is known as lockjaw or trismus. Okay. And what happens, this is there is contraction of the jaw muscles, which prevents the mouth from opening, and it gives a special features to the facial muscle contraction and known as risus sardonicus. Okay, then another very important feature which is seen in such patient is opisthotonus, that is arching of the back. The spasm of the extensor muscles of the back take place. This gives arching of the back. Then usually such patient, they die, and that is because of the respiratory failure. Okay. Now coming to the biochemical characteristics to diagnose this bacteria in the lab, we go for microscopy. In the microscopy, we see the morphology, how they appear in shape and color. So they appear long and slender, and they do not have any capsule, rather they have a terminal round spore. In this picture, I have pointed out this bacteria, where you can see this bacteria has a drumstick like appearance. Okay. Further, for lab diagnosis, we also do culture. And as I have told you, this is an anaerobe, so it grows in absence of the oxygen. Okay, gram positive, as I have told you, they are gram positive, and they produce swarming on the blood agar. What is swarming? Swarming means when the growth of the bacteria is too much, that covers the whole area of the media. And they also produce a little hemolysis. Hemolysis when it causes lysis of the RBCs. Okay. Now, further biochemical properties of this bacteria is that does not ferment any carbohydrate and proteins, and it is very resistant and can remain alive about 10 years in soil. Okay. Now, this is a very good picture. That is showing the pathogenesis of tetanus caused by tetani. In this, has numbering has been given, how the wound, this Clostridium tetani, they enter the wound, then the spread of toxin takes place, and it causes rigid paralysis, lockjaw, cardiac failure, and respiratory failure. Okay. Now, this picture is a Tunas, which I told you, that is an arcing of the this back muscles because of the contraction of the extensor muscles of the back. This is a lockjaw trismus, that is because of the contraction of the facial muscles. It gives us a special features to the face, that is known as recess sardonicus. Okay. Now coming to the main diagnosis, mainly this disease is diagnosed on clinical signs and symptoms that are very specific, and rarely the organism is isolated in lab. And in the differential diagnosis, we should look also for rabies and meningitis, because they have similar symptoms to the tetanus. Okay. So this is already, I've told you, this picture is more clear, in which you can see it has a terminal spore. Now coming to the treatment. Treatment usually given is tetanus immunoglobulin, which is a, which can neutralize the toxin. And here the antibiotic role is uncertain. However, if necessary, we can give metronidazole or penicillin G. Further, respiratory support is very important to maintain the airway, and further benzodiazepines also given to prevent the spasm. The prevention is very important in Clostridium tetani. For this, a vaccine is given in childhood and every 10 years, and it is given in combination with diphtheria toxide and pertussis vaccine, that is DPT. And whenever the trauma is, happens, for example, in a road traffic accident, which is very common, it should, the wound should be cleaned and dried, and then the tetanus toxoid booster should be given. And if the wound is grossly contaminated, then the tetanus immunoglobulin along with the toxoid booster and penicillin should be given. Now coming to the second type of the Clostridium, that is Clostridium botulinum. This is also a very important species that causes a disease known as botulism. How it is transmitted? By the soil contaminated food. Usually, as I've told you, these as Clostridium tetanus, this also is found in soil. And especially the spores in the soil, they contaminate food, especially vegetables and meat. Vegetables when not washed properly, and meat if it is not cooked. And especially this type of the transmission is taken place when the food are canned or vacuum packed without adequate sterilization. And in what happens, the spores, they survive and germinate the anaerobic environment, and the exotoxin in food is found, and it is basically ingested. That is how the transmission takes place. High risk food considered include canned green beans, pepper, mushrooms, smoked fish, which are readily available nowadays in the supermarkets, and people are usually fond of having these for easy cooking purposes. Now coming to the pathogenesis of Clostridium botulinum, that includes the toxin. The toxin, botulinum toxin, is basically absorbed from the gut, and it is carried to the blood to the peripheral nerve synapses, where it blocks the release of acetylcholine, which is also the most toxic substances known. And it is also a protease that cleaves the protein involving acetylcholine release. And this toxin has 8 immunologic types. Mainly type A, B, and E are most common in human illness. Another important feature of this toxin is that nowadays Botox is a used commercially, which is in which the exotoxin A is found, which helps to remove the wrinkles on the face in aged people. Okay, other diseases which are being in which there is chances of spasm, like writer's cramp and blepharospasm. Here it is also used to as a treatment purposes to treat the spasm, and this is very helpful in such cases. Now coming to the clinical findings. The clinical findings is basically the person do not have any fever. Rather, when the spores they germinate and produce toxin at the wound site, it causes descending muscle weakness and paralysis, and that includes diplopia, in which you usually a person has a double vision, and dysphagia, in which the person has difficulty in eating, and respiratory muscle failure. Another important feature which is found is that the infants are readily involved in this pathogenesis, and where the organism grow in gut and produce toxins, especially when the children's after birth they have been given honey to ingest, and that results in botulism, and the infant usually develop weakness or paralysis, and sometime also need respiratory support. This is a picture of a child which is suffering with botulism. Now coming to the laboratory diagnosis of the Clostridium botulinum. In this, usually the culture is not done. Rather, the detection of the botulinum toxin in the uneaten food and the patient serum is done by a method which is mouse protection test method, in which what happens, the mouse are inoculated with the sample of the clinical specimen, and if the mouse will die unless protected by the antitoxin, that shows that specimen is that of the food is having this toxin. Okay, now coming to the treatment. The treatment is usually involves given trivalent antitoxin A, B, and E with the respiratory support. Prevention involves the proper sterilization of the canned and vacuum packed food, and if there any this canned food is stolen, should be discarded. Food should be adequately cooked in order to inactivate any toxin present in the food. Now coming to the third species, that is Clostridium perfringens. It causes two diseases, which depends on the different type of route of entry, that is gas gangrene and food poisoning. Now first of all, what is gas gangrene? Gas gangrene, also known as myonecrosis and necrotizing fasciitis, in which basically the spores in the soil, they enter the wound, and usually the other species which are involved in causing the gas gangrene is Clostridium histolyticum, Clostridium septicum, Clostridium novae, Clostridium sordelli. Clostridium sordelli usually causes toxic shock syndrome in postpartum and post-abortion women. As I've already told you, the transmission takes place by the contamination of the wound with the soil in which the spores are present. Gas gangrene is associated with the war wounds, automobile and motorcycle accidents, and septic abortions, and also in endometriosis. Now coming to the pathogenesis, this organism usually grow in traumatized tissue, and especially muscles are involved in such cases, and where it produces toxin. The toxin is known as alpha toxin or lecithinase, which damages cell membrane, including of the erythrocytes, resulting in hemolysis and degraded enzymes, which produces gas in the tissue. Clinical findings of the Clostridium perfringens include pain, edema, and cellulitis and gangrene in the wound area. Further, crepitations are also found, in which basically these crepitations indicate the presence of the gas in the tissue. Further, hemolysis and jaundice is also common in such cases, and mortality rate is very high, and death is found usually due to shock. In this picture, you can see the person, a wound has been gangrened. Next is how to diagnose. For the laboratory diagnosis, the specimen usually used is wound tissue and pus. In the microscopy, usually the gram-positive rods are seen, but here spores not seen usually because they are found under nutritionally deficient conditions. Okay, culture is usually done on blood agar, and there it shows double zone of hemolysis. Another agar, egg yolk agar. In addition to blood agar, another agar is used, egg yolk agar, which helps to see the presence of this toxin Lysine thymase. The treatment include penicillin G, which is considered the antibiotic of choice, and also it is necessary to do the debridement of the wound. The prevention includes the penicillin for using as a prophylaxis and cleaning of the wound, and there is no vaccine available for this disease. Now, the second disease which it causes is food poisoning. Food poisoning is usually caused by the exotoxin which is being ingested in the food, and the transmission takes place by the spores which contaminate the food. The spores are heat resistant and they survive cooking and they germinate, especially in reheated foods or meat dishes. Food poisoning involves pathogenesis of enterotoxin, which causes diarrhea, and this enterotoxin acts as a super antigen, where it causes large number of release of interleukin and tumor necrosis factor, and this super antigen, it acts just like as that of the Staph aureus antigen. Clinical findings involved incubation period of 8 to 16 hours, and usually the person has watery diarrhea with abdominal cramps and little vomiting, and these symptoms usually resolve in 24 hours. Usually in these cases, the lab diagnosis is not done, and the large number of the organisms are usually isolated from the uneaten food. Treatment involves symptomatic treatment, in which IV fluid is maintained, and person is usually try to not dehydrate in such conditions, and no antimicrobial drugs are given. Prevention is no specific means, rather only prevention is that the food should be adequately cooked. Now the fourth and the last one is the Clostridium difficile. The Clostridium difficile, it causes a disease, pseudomembranous colitis, which is antibiotic associated disease, and this is considered the most common nosocomial cause of the diarrhea. Nosocomial, that is hospital acquired type of the disease. Here you can see this pseudomembranous ulcerative colitis, in which pseudomembrane is formed in the intestine due to the bacterial overgrowth. Usually in this, the organism is carried in GIT in 3% of the general population and 30% of the hospital patient. And most people are not colonized. And this is explains why the most people do not get pseudomembranous colitis even they take the antibiotics. How it is transmitted? By fecal oral route and through the hands of the hospital personnel, that is the intermediators. What is the pathogenesis? The pathogenesis involved in this disease is that whenever a person is taking antibiotics for a long time, these antibiotics, they suppress the drug sensitive membranes of the normal flora, एंड देन व्हाट दे डू दे अलाउ द क्लोस्ट्रीडियम डिफिसिट टू मल्टीप्लाई एंड प्रोड्यूस एक्सोटॉक्सिन एंड देन दिस एक्सोटॉक्सिन कॉज लॉस ऑफ साइटोस्केलेटल इंटीग्रिटी एपोप्टोसिस एंड डेथ ऑफ एंटीरोसाइट्स. The first antibiotic which is, has been recognized to cause pseudomembranous colitis is clindamycin. Now the second and the third generation cephalosporin are also involved to cause this pseudomembranous colitis. Ampicillin and fluoroquinolones are also mostly used and involved in its pathogenesis. Cancer therapy can also produce spores pseudomembranous colitis. Clostridium difficile rarely invades the intestinal mucosa. The clinical finding is that in such disease, the person has a non-bloody diarrhea, which is associated with formation of pseudomembranes, which are yellow-white plaques on the colonic mucosa, which I have already shown you in the previous slide, how they appear on the intestinal mucosa. Usually in such patients they have a fever and abdominal cramping, and the abdominal pseudomembrane are visualized by sigmoidoscopy, and neutrophils can be found in the stool in 50% of cases. Toxic megacolon is very common in such patient, and usually the surgical resection of the colon is found to do necessary procedure. Further lab diagnosis involve detection of exotoxin in the patient's stool. This presence of the exotoxin in the flagellate of the patient's stool is the basis of the lab diagnosis. The isolation of the Clostridium difficile from the stool is followed by the evidence that the isolate is a toxin producing. And however, the process is time consuming, cannot be completed in a clinical relevant time. What we are using to test that this exotoxin ELISA, which is a rapid less sensitive test, but cytotoxicity test is more sensitive, in which what we do, we use the human cells in culture exposed to exotoxin in stool filtrate, and death of the cells is usually absorbed, and it is more sensitive than ELISA. And it takes 24 to 48 hours of incubation time, but it is insufficient to culture that stool for the presence of Clostridium difficile, because the people can be colonized by the organism and they do not have the disease. Further, PCR assay is also done for the looking for the presence of toxin gene DNA. Treatment is usually to stop the antibiotic, any drug which is being used and which is considered the causative agent in this disease. Then further fluid replacement is also done. Then oral metronidazole or vancomycin can be given, but vancomycin is given for life-threatening cases because it is more effective in than the metronidazole. Further, surgical resection of the colon is also done in case of toxic megacolon in the life-threatening cases. Recurrences is seen in many patients which are being treated, and they do not eradicate the carrier state, and the recurrent episodes can occur. Usually for such patients, fidaxomicin deficit is usually given in both treatment and prevention of the relapses. Further, another technique is used known as fecal bacteriotherapy, which is having a very high cure rate. What happens in this fecal bacteriotherapy, we administer boiled flora, that is the bacteria which are present in the bowel, which from the normal individual, it is transferred by animal to the patient with pseudomembranous colitis. In this, what happens, Clostridium difficile is being replaced with the normal bowel flora. It has a very high cure rate, but safety issues have limited its acceptance. The prevention of the Clostridium difficile include this no vaccine or drug given. Rather, antibiotics should be prescribed only when necessary, and the prophylaxis to prevent is not recommended. This is another very good table in which all these species of the Clostridium have been compared, what diseases they cause, how they are transmitted, and what is the action of toxin in such diseases happens, and what is the prevention. So in which you can easily go through the all species. Thank you. Now, any questions, please, I'm here to answer. Any questions? For the Clostridium difficile, culture is not recommended. Culture is not a good test to do. Rather, there are other tests in which we can do the ELISA, we can do the cytotoxicity test, we can do the PCR assay, but culture is not good, because in which the person may have this colonized with the bacteria but do not have the disease. So important is to test, to look for the toxin, not the bacteria. Important here is to look for the toxin, to detect the exotoxin. I will come show you the slide again of this, where you can see. Here you can see. Important thing is to test the exotoxin, not the culture. Any other question? Deficit is a drug. Yes, deficit is a drug. I show you about this drug. Yeah, this is a drug. Okay. Other question. What is toxic megacolon? Okay. What happens because of the release of this exotoxin, this megacolon happens, which the colon increase in size than the normal size. Because of the release of so many this exotoxin, and the mucosa is ulcerated, and it has pseudomembrane in it, that causes toxic megacolon. Presence of exotoxin in increased amount in the colon makes it toxic. Other question? Okay. What is superantigen? Superantigen, I told you, in this, there is increased release of interleukin and tumor necrosis factor. That is increased release of the cytokines. And that that is also seen in a case of Staph aureus food poisoning. Okay. Now, what is known as double zone of hemolysis? What happens, hemolysis occurs, is usually seen in blood agar. We see the hemolysis in blood agar in the media. And what happens, hemolysis shows this lysis of the RBCs. In the blood agar, we are using human blood. In the media, we are using the human blood. And what happens, the growth of the bacteria causes the lysis of the RBCs, that causes hemolysis. clear zone is formed. But in this type of the pathogen growth, the zone is double, like one circle and another circle. Two circles are formed, double zone. That is specific of this bacterial growth. Okay, two circles will be seen of lysis of RBCs. You can see, I have not actually taken the picture of this in the top of the lecture. But if you look in the Google, you can see double zone hemolysis picture of it. What is crepitation? Crepitation is basically what happens in this infection of the Clostridium perfringens, in which the gas gangrene is formed in the wound area. What happens, the crepitations they develop in the Clostridium perfringens. What happens, they cause necrosis tissue and production of gas in the tissue. And when you touch and when you tap it on it, you feel a certain voice that shows the gas is present in the tissue. Fecal bacterial therapy. Fecal bacterial therapy is a technique which is mainly used in the disease of pseudomembranous colitis. Because what happens, being used antibiotic for a long time, the normal flora of the that person is suppressed. Now the that person bowel has excess amount of this Clostridium deficit, but other normal flora is suppressed. Now what happens, this fecal bacterial therapy is used, which in which this technique, what happens, we take the bowel flora from another person and we insert this bowel flora through enema into the patient who's having the pseudomembranous colitis. In this way, either we are replacing the excess amount of the Clostridium deficit with the normal bowel flora. Okay. Skin popping. Skin popping, basically this is a technique which is causing a disease of Clostridium tetani. What happens, the drug addicts, they use this technique to take the these drugs. And in which what they do, they use this certain kind of needles to inject these drugs like heroin into the skin. And this technique is known as skin popping. Any other questions? I have tried to answer all the questions so far seen in the chat box. Okay, super antigen. I have told you that super antigen is basically the toxin which is being released in the food poisoning of the Clostridium perfringens. Okay, Clostridium perfringens has this two diseases. I can open the slide for you in which you can see. 1 minute. Yeah. Okay, in which I have told you that Clostridium perfringens is causing food poisoning. The food poisoning is caused by the super antigen. This super antigen, what it causes, it causes increased release of the interleukin and tumor necrosis factor. That is, increased surge of the cytokines is released because of the presence of this toxin. And this super antigen is also released in Staph aureus food poisoning. Okay. So this is actually the mechanism of the super antigen. No, this bacterial therapy is not causing immune reaction so far. The mechanism has been given, but usually the acceptance is low. We are not using formally this technique. Enema is usually used for this bacterial therapy. Yes, super antigen cause excessive activation of the immune system. That is why after the activation of the immune system, the cytokines are released that include the interleukin and a tumor necrosis factor. Okay, Botox. Botox, which I have told you, is used commercially. Which we are using this toxin botulinum, okay, and this is usually you very used by the cosmetic surgeons nowadays for stop the aging process. In this, what we do, we inject this exotoxin A to remove the wrinkles on the face. Okay. How it, you have seen that this Clostridium botulinum has a pathogenesis just opposite to the Clostridium tetani. In the Clostridium tetani, it causes contraction. But in the Clostridium botulinum, the action is opposite. It causes relaxation. It causes increased relaxation of the muscles. You understand? So this is how it is preventing the wrinkles. It is just the opposite of the Clostridium tetani. In the Clostridium tetani, there is increased contraction. In the Clostridium botulinum, the toxin causes increased relaxation of the muscles. So this is how the Botox is helping to remove the wrinkles. Sometimes amputation is done in gas gangrene patients when the area involved is quite big. And it is not helping, the treatment is cannot be okay. Thank you. I'm now.